But the real point is this. The real guardians of progress are no longer politicians at Westminster or even at Holyrood, but the energised activism of tens of thousands of people who I predict will refuse to meekly go back into the political shadows. For me, right now, this is a process which is not about me or the SNP or any political party. It's much, much more important than that. It continues. And the dream shall never die.
There is a phrase, the unwritten constitution of the UK, and actually that is inaccurate, and many legal scholars will say it's inaccurate. We have a written constitution, it's just that it's written in all kinds of different documents. So what we've got is an uncodified document. But if you go and look up UK unwritten constitution, here's what you're going to find. You might find yourself up on the page of the British Library, which has a wonderful article about where the constitution exists, and it'll take you through Magna Carta, the Declaration of Parliament, the Bill of Rights, and then on to the present, without a single mention of Scotland having any constitutional documents. So what happened? How did the pre-Union English Constitution suddenly become the post-Union Scottish Constitution? How did we all become English and bound by conventions, which, by the way, people will say, in terms of Scottish excavation of the Constitution, my goodness, that's ancient history, isn't it? I mean, why are you bothering with that? Let's deal with today's realities. Today's realities include something called parliamentary sovereignty, which says that Parliament is sovereign over the people, and a million people on the streets don't have as much influence as a corporate lobbyist. It's up to Parliament. That's parliamentary sovereignty. High Court ruled in 2016 that there was no requirement for Parliament, for the judges, to listen to the electorate. You know, Scotland had a very different system, and our ancestors, when they signed that forced marriage contract, and it was a contract, they put in a prenup. They did. They put in a get-out clause. The get-out was, and this was done, whatever you think of the Presbyterian Kirk, and I have Presbyterian ancestors going all the way back, they were worried that Scotland would lose her character, her judicial character, her religious character, and her constitutional character. So they made it a condition of the Union and the treaty. It is a crime in Scotland to claim that a parliament is sovereign over the people. It is a crime punishable by forfeiture of power. It is a crime to attack human rights. It is a crime to attack the right to process, to protest in Scotland. It is a crime to give money to your pals. It is a, without parliamentary oversight, it is a crime to use the law to go after your political enemies. The map that the abuser in the marriage will give you to get out is gaslighting. We have a way out. And that way out is to get the people of Scotland together, back up off their knees after the treachery and the betrayal and the centuries of abuse we have suffered, and explain you are sovereign in Scotland. You lend your power to any government and you can take it back, not by saying, oh, well, we'll vote in another party. You can sack them and you can replace them. So we are asking to send this wonder to the whole of Scotland and the whole of the world and the international courts. This is our law. This is the crime that's been committed against us. And we will, thank you very much, be reconvening the Assembly of the People that was known as the Convention of the Estates, putting this government on trial, and when they are found guilty, sacking them.